If we have a superimposed state with phase associated with it, we can see that we pass it through the NOT gate, and we still see that that inverting nature, B ket 1 into the NOT gate, that's going to result in a state of B ket 0 plus alpha ket 1. So those probability amplitudes associated with our quantum state are going to be exchanged because of the NOT gate. So that's the NOT gate's functionality. So if we take that output that we produced from the NOT gate and pass it back through the NOT operation, so beta or B ket 0 plus A ket 1, we'll see that exchange of information once again in the form of those probability amplitudes changing or being exchanged and recovering that original input state. So we can see that once again, we were able to recover our original input by applying the NOT gate twice. Okay, great. So reversibility is a requirement for quantum computation, but this is pretty unique. It's one of the things that kind of makes quantum computation a little bit different from classical computation, because classical computation is not inherently reversible. There are some classical implementations operations that are reversible, but they're not. It's not a rule that we have to follow like it is for quantum computing. So let's think of a couple examples. So the classical NOT gate, that is basically equivalent to our NOT gate that we use in quantum computing, the classical NOT gate, that's reversible, but other operations are not reversible. So let's look at an example. So here we're gonna look at the logical AND operation. And as a little refresher, the classical AND operation has two inputs and a single output. And any out and the output is one is achieved if and only if both inputs are equal to one. So let's look at that with in symbolic form with our information encoded as black and white balls. So here, if we have two inputs of 0 and 0 passing through an AND gate, 0 and 0 is going to result in 0. So if we have 0 and 1 passing through our AND gate, 0 and 1 will also result in a 0. 0 and 1 results in a 0 as well. So if either of these inputs have a 0 associated with them, we end up with a 0. And then finally, our unique case where we have 1 and 1 enter in the AND gate to produce a output of 1. So this is a visualization, kind of a little showing the information in the truth table associated with the AND gate, that the output is going to be 1 if and only if both inputs are equal to 1. So we said that a lot of classical gates are not reversible. Let's confirm this with the AND gate. So is AND reversible? Well, we just discussed how if we have an output or an input of 1 and 1, we get a output of 1. But in all other cases, we get an output of 0. So this makes it a little ambiguous. There's really only one case where we can guarantee and with 100% certainty that we know the inputs. So to answer the question, the logical AND operation from classical computing is not reversible, because in these three cases specifically, we are not able to generate the inputs from the output. So let's look at that in a little bit more depth. So if we have 1 and 1, we know that our output is going to be 1. But if our output is 0, we don't know for certainty what exactly these two inputs are going to be. It could be a 0 and 0. It could be a 0 and 1. We know that one of these inputs will be white because that is the other three options we have for inputs for our AND operation. But we can't tell for certainty which one is or if they're both white. So to be reversible, there's a couple of rules we have to follow for those functions. So let's kind of take some observations that we made from the previous examples when we looked at NOT, when we looked at CNOT, when we looked at the H gate. for a gate to be reversible or for an operation to be reversible, we need to make sure that all outputs have unique combinations. And there has to be at least as many outputs as inputs. So what is reversible? Reversible operations must have an equal number of inputs and outputs, but that's not strictly the only guideline we have to follow. So here, we're starting off with our AND operation, or we're starting off with the operation with a single input, so we're passing through the top argument. And then we're passing through this bottom argument as well. And even though we have matching numbers of inputs and outputs, we don't have a truly reversible function here because we have the case where we have two sets of outputs. So here and here that are identical. So this would not be an example of a reversible function. So as we saw, or to kind of summarize, we have three choices that have a white ball as a second output. So we tried to follow this step to make a reversible function, but we don't quite have one since even though we have inputs that are all unique, we have two cases where the outputs match. So in the next video, we're gonna talk about, or in the next lecture, we're gonna talk about techniques that we'll use to make functions that are not inherently reversible. So let's go into a little bit of example of developing a function and seeing if it is reversible. So this is a arbitrary function called foo, and we've defined the inputs and outputs associated with foo. So let's go through them. So with 0, 0, we're going to have an output of 0, 1. With 0, 1, we're going to have an output of 0, 0. With 1, 0, we're going to have an output of 1, 1. And with 1, 1, we're going to have an output of 1, 0. So the notation, or the convention I'm using, as a side note, whenever I'm listing the names of the qubits, very similar like we've done back in class, but just as a refresher, going from top down when combining those qubits. So 0, 0, 1, 0. When we list the qubits in a quantum circuit. So let's see if this is reversible. So first test that we have to kind of, it is a good indicator. The first test that we have to see if it may be reversible is to check the inputs and outputs. And are there the same number of inputs and outputs, and are they unique? So we have four unique input combinations. So 1, 2, 3, 4. We have two inputs in each of them, two outputs in all of them, and then we also have four unique output combinations. So far we're following the rules that indicate that this function may be reversible. So let's try out a little bit more, or let's investigate a little bit further to see if this function foo is truly reversible. So given an output, can we regenerate that input? So our output, 1, 0, if we send that back into foo, we get 0, 1, or sorry, we get 1, 1. And then if we send 1, 1 back through foo, we get 1, 0. So here we can confirm that foo is its own inverse and it is reversible. So to finalize, let's go ahead and make the matrix for foo. So here, we have 0, 0, and that corresponds to 0, 1. We have 0, 1, and that corresponds to 0, 0, 1, 0. So that will correspond to 1, 1, and 1, 1 corresponding to 1, 0. So here is the mapping of inputs to outputs. And this is in Brockett notation. So we need to take this information and convert it into matrix representation. So here we can fill in the rows. And we can see that if we have a input of 0, 0, that produces an output of 0, 1, so that corresponds with this first column. 0, 1, that produces an output of 0, 0, so that corresponds to the second column. 1, 0, that corresponds to the third column and produces an output of 1, 1. So here we go. And then 1, 1, corresponding to the output of 1, 0. And that corresponds to this last final column in the matrix. So we can make the matrix and we confirm that it is reversible and it acts as its own inverse. So to summarize, reversibility, a very important concept in quantum computing because all quantum operations have to be reversible so that no information is lost. What does that mean? That means that the input can be recovered from the output, and that is done through the inverse of a function. So many of the functions we've described in class and we'll probably be sticking with in this course are self-inverse. And what that means is that you can take a gate, you can use it consecutively, and then be able to recover your original input. As a final note to take away, many operations from classical computing are not reversible. We'll kind of talk a little bit more about that. In our next set of slides, we'll look at a function and see that it's not inherently reversible and make some modifications in order to transform it into a reversible form. We'll also dive a little bit deeper into the mathematical meaning of reversibility as well. And that will come in another series of lecture slides.